living now as a Jew, as a Brit, being able to do these things, particularly across Germany. You know, Hitler would be turning in his grave.
Hi, so my name's Robert Desmond, and I'm a software developer, but I'm also a keen cyclist. I've done several physical challenges over the years. I really enjoy getting outside, doing things that push me to the limit, that exhaust me, that inspire other people, that get other people along with me. And I'm starting a new adventure to cycle from London down to Auschwitz in Poland. I'm going to follow a liberation path. It should be an interesting and emotional trip. But I'm going to try and look at the bright side of everything, take everything as positive. This is a path that helped liberate the world and make the world a better place. So it's Sunday, September 29th. The bike's all ready. All my friends are here to say goodbye.
Bye, man.
Love you lot.
Right, so I've literally just left home. I'm still in Camden. It suddenly hit me that I'm going to be on the road for the next month. It's going to be tough, but you know what? It's going to be fun. This is where the decisions were all taken during World War II to actually start that incredibly important attack on the D-Day landings on the Normandy beaches to push into France, to push back against the Nazis, and to eventually win the war and liberate the whole of France, the whole of the European countries that have been invaded. This journey that I'm starting today was all dreamt up here and decided on here. So day one's complete. I've had sort of emotional time saying goodbye to lots of friends, staying positive, and this is gonna be a good trip. Morning, Mr. Cal, how are you? How are you guys doing? Right, so I'm in a town called Alton on my second day, second morning, and I've just come across a World War I memorial and then a World War II addition on the end. So I've managed to stop in a town with a very cool name called Markerworthy. So this is a very small town. There's a war memorial for World War I here. And then on the back, a World War II plaque.
France, Belgium, Norway, US, Australia, Great Britain, New Zealand, South America, Denmark. These are all signatures from the Air Force people, I guess.
Yeah.
And it was Douglas Bader, who supposedly lost either one or both of his legs.
We're going to check that when we get back.
We'll check that.
To Google.
And then still went out and flew in the war.
Yeah.
Pretty impressive. Maybe I should have done this in the height of summer as opposed to... So the final attached to a youth exchange project of young people from France and Germany. A symbolic project to artistically redesign the surface of four German bunkers at a place steeped in history like this is supported by the society. Feels very odd being here, especially sort of alone. Simmons Road in honour of Private J.H. Simmons, killed in action June 13th, 1944, so a week after the landing. So Utah was the most western attack beach, and then the next one was Omaha, Gold, Juno and Sword. This one was attacked by the Americans and a lot of paratroopers went over, and then they ended up taking Carentan. Utah Beach to Czechoslovakia. Five campaigns, 318 days, marked by great cost of precious lives and extraordinary valour. The tough hombres accomplished every mission, shoulder to shoulder, with American, French and other allied units. They liberated Europe and made a better world. It's kind of poignant, it just started raining on me. The memorials here are very good.
and just been going around the very moving place. Oh, it's day four today. Day four already. Can't believe it. So unbelievably peaceful out here. So this monument here is the Pointe du Hoc, which was a very strong gun position that the Germans had. Just over 200 Rangers to attack this on the morning of the D-Day landings. Due to a navigational error, they got lost and had to scale about 3 miles of cliffs and hills until they eventually came to the guns here. And the element of surprise was kind of lost. Out of the 215 or so that started, only 90 survived, but they managed to destroy the guns and hold out for a really critical position in the D-Day landings. The final quote on that board back there said that they started, or they initiated, the take back of Europe. Looking at the landscape here, there's nothing but serious artillery damage. Every 5 meters is another crater. And we are quite high up on this cliff. Quite an impressive feat to climb up there. Another similar defence seems to have been blown completely open. And all around you can see these tunnels that allow you to get between one and the other. Quite a few of them have collapsed. But this whole area supposedly goes along the coastline for miles and miles and miles. Doing this completely on my own is a bit of a weird experience, because normally, you know, you have your contemplative time whilst you're at the memorials or such, and then you sort of get back in the car or walk off with your friends and family, and you joke about things and you come back to reality. For me, I'm just kind of by myself and just constantly thinking, which is a bit of a different feeling. This is the Omaha Beach, which I just cycled down. This is the place where these attacks started happening. From way out there, across the channel from England, gathering the night before, bringing all these tanks, vehicles, supplies, people, weapons to attack this small hill as the first step. It took weeks before even where I stayed last night in Carentan that was taken, and then months before Paris was even taken, and I'm hoping to be there in a couple of days. This really was just the start. So it's day five now, and I'm in Ken. Woke up this morning to a lot of rain, quite a lot of fatigue. Yeah, I got my coffee because I need it, but you know, always look on the bright side of life. Yeah, I'm not gonna put that in. I'm standing outside Peace Museum, the whole World War Museum here in Ken. Absolutely fascinating exhibition, definitely worth the trip, and absolutely brilliant. And again, it sort of reinforced the meaning of this trip. So I'm going into a headwind. What does it say? Always look on the bright side of life. Right now I gotta keep pushing, keep pedaling, keep those legs turning. On this liberation route, I found a Rue de la Libération, Saint-Désir. Burials of the Second World War,
569 are British, 16 Canadian, 6 Australian, 5 South African, 1 New Zealand and 1 from the US. 4 British soldiers of the First World War are also now buried here.
So I've managed to reach Versailles, the Palace of Versailles, which is just over here, and met the people next to me. I've got Gary here,
who
lives down the road in Islington.
Yeah.
And this is where the Treaty of Versailles were signed at the end of World War I. Now that's a room. What an eerie feeling as well, as you step into here. It's absolutely massive. You can definitely get a sense of grand things happening here. Germany can't enter into any military action. It can defend places, but it can't attack anywhere. So that's why whenever Europe go into another country, Germany doesn't join. Germany is not allowed to join. Germany promised it won't. Absolutely incredible. It used to be someone's home.
What's that about?
That's ridiculous. La Tour Eiffel. What a great feeling to have made it to Paris. 6 days. 6 days, something like 650 kilometers. Anyone want some turnips? I saw this large cemetery with French flags all around it. I estimated there were probably about 2,000 gravestones there, which just sort of came out of nowhere. And all along the road, I mean, I've been past through a few, but I've been so exhausted I haven't stopped for them. This one, I thought, I'm just coming to the end of my day here, fallen dead for France. 13th of June 1940, Lieutenant Henry Cos. So, you know, I can't really complain. I'm fit and healthy. I don't have to sit in a trench. I don't have to die. I don't have to get shot at. It's a bit morbid, really. Got to keep a smile on my face. Should be happy to be alive, happy to be doing it, being able to do these things. So these were the forests where World War I had a lot of fighting. In the forest of Verdun, there were 8 villages that were destroyed. They died for France. The villagers died for France. And it's here, actually, where all these plaques are, which signify, you can see one just there, and just here. There's a few other floating around that signify where all of the houses were. February 1916, the Germans began the shelling, and it started snowing. Supposedly the horizon was on fire. It just must have been absolutely terrifying. This is definitely the biggest gravesite I've seen. To the flag in the middle, where you can see the row of trees, that's only half of it. Absolutely huge. In the bottom of the building, there's 130,000 people commemorated, all the dead bodies that were found after the war that had no names attached. They were all collected. Germans, Allies, whoever was there was just put together in the bottom of this building here that I've just visited. This is kind of incomprehensible. This is Joy, and she works here. She lives here in this American cemetery just outside of Luxembourg, and she's very kindly, despite the American shutdown, the government shutdown, she's very kindly offered to take the camera, not me, but take the camera down to the cemetery so I can at least see what it looks like. So thank you very much, Joy.
The edge of the terrace, you see the 5,076 headstones that are in our cemetery. General Patton was an important commander during the Battle of the Bulge. He brought the Third Army up from Metz, France, and his army fought during the Battle of the Bulge, and were actually the group that ended up liberating the people in Bastogne. General Patton died on the 21st of December 1945 after a car crash broke his neck on the 9th of December, and he was brought here to this cemetery on December 24th, 1945, and interred because he asked his wife that he be buried with his men. And since so many of his people fought during the Battle of the Bulge, he was brought here.
Okay, so I'm out here riding the mountains. It's gorgeous, but man, it is steep. This hill is ongoing, absolutely massive. I don't think I'm even halfway up it. But I found some pretty looking mushrooms on the side of the road. So it's a good excuse to stop to investigate nature, right? Look at that, look at that. Don't eat that. Yeah, really don't eat that. Keep on moving! You try sometime, you just might find, you just might find, you get what you need. Oh yeah! Woo! You can't always get what you want. Woo! So I've stumbled across the first memorial that I've seen in Germany. I'm a day and a half into Germany. I've done, 120 odd miles into Germany. First memorial I've seen. So it was here behind me in the Nuremberg trial room where the Nuremberg trials after World War II took place. 21 people were persecuted, were tried, of which 18 were given either lengthy jail sentences or most of which were actually sentenced to death by hanging. Three managed to be acquitted of their crimes. Walking into that courtroom was very odd, very, very weird. I hadn't really thought about the whole Nuremberg trials at all today, and it was the first thing I walked into, and it just felt very, very odd. This is where the Nazi party would have had rallies. Hitler would have stand right here and address all of his population, who would no doubt be sitting up and down all along, all in front of this field.
These speeches would have been to gather people together to rise up against the minorities in the culture, whether they be Jews, blacks.
One of the most scary sights for many people at Auschwitz are the train tracks. Train, not as modern as that, would have taken the victims from all around the country, all around this area, to places like Flossenbürg and other camps. So behind me is the Flossenbürg concentration camp. Set up in 1939, it was set up here in Flossenbürg because around the whole area there's a lot of granite, as you can see, which was quarried by the prisoners. Initially there were 400 put up here. That rose to about 15,000. And they recorded about 100,000 prisoners who went through the camp throughout the years. It was freed in 1945 eventually by US Army. The prisoners were not just Jewish, they came from, about half of them were Polish, or if they had political beliefs or any other things that went against the regime that the Nazis wanted to uphold. This was just the central hub in Flossenbürg. There are 100 smaller work places where the inmates would go and quarry this granite from around this area. And it's all over this Bavaria town, or Bavaria part of Germany. If anyone tried to escape or anyone was caught doing any other offences that were deemed to be wrong, they could be sentenced to death and they would be killed in front of the rest of the prisoners right here in this central roll call ground. Every morning, every evening, the prisoners were counted, standing to attention often for hours. This was an additional torture for no doubt the inadequately clothed. I mean, I'm wearing quite a lot of clothes and it's only October and I'm still cold. I couldn't stand out here for hours. It says here that after the war, the perpetrators of these camps were basically allowed to integrate back into society quite easily. Only the prisoners and their organisations continued to campaign against them. The statue shows a man who was one of the opponents of Hitler. He was unfortunately killed in the courtyard that we've just seen, early April 1945, just early in the month when the camp was liberated by the American army. This document here shows 100 of the inmates who perished after the camp was freed due to the effects of their imprisonment. So I met an Englishman last night and he said it's such a shame that this was done here and that it's crazy that it was going on and nobody knew about it. I mean, I said, I'm sure that's not right. I'm sure people knew about it. You couldn't not know about it. Here's proof. Here are a few letters. Here's one from a plumbing company. When they knew that there was going to be a camp here, they came in and said we could work for you. Same one for an electrical installation company and a German newspaper. The SS, the ones who worked here, they stayed in houses that were rented out by the local population, so the local population benefited from it. And they also set up businesses and trading with them. They got prisoners to work for them for cheap, doing gardening, all that sort of stuff. And they even created underground ammunition factories, which would help the German army, essentially, rearm themselves throughout the war. So it was about 30,000 that died here. It was massively, massively overcrowded. They caused serious malnutrition, overworking. There's no health and safety at all. They would forcibly whip people, execute people in front of others if they weren't pulling their weight, if they didn't think they were working hard enough, they would be executed. I'm just standing here next to a memorial which is entitled "These are the ashes and bones from mass burnings." Very strange how sort of after the war, in this memorial here, in this museum, in the exhibition, they mentioned how a lot of people managed to get off. They were recognised as being officers in the camp by survivors, and they were just sort of pardoned, accused of doing ridiculous things, whipping, ordering people to be shot, torturing. You know, these were absolutely ridiculous allegations that have been proven with footage, photos, many accounts, and yet a lot of people managed to sort of get away with it. Still, whenever I mention it to Germans that I'm doing this trip and I'm finishing in Auschwitz, they sort of turn to me and they stop sort of any particular flow of conversation. They don't really know what to say. All political opposers were actually sent to the camps. There were a lot of people here that were even German, but they opposed politically the Nazi regime. And they were sent here and they were killed. I don't know what this building is. Probably the crematorium. That's nice. Oh. Welcome to Czech Republic. Wow. Now that's a picture. Well, it's day 19, I'm in the Czech Republic. Just leaving the hotel that I stayed at, which is very nice and very cheap, which is good. I have absolutely no idea where I'm going, but probably into those crowds. Come across a few more liberation memorials to the US Army that liberated some of the areas here in May 1945. I haven't seen these liberation memorials since France, really. All throughout Germany there was nothing, no significant liberation memorials at all. There were a few sort of First World War and a couple, if at all, Second World War memorials. It's quite moving to know or to re-realize that I'm on this liberation path. Good morning, day 23. It's cold, it's a little bit damp. Yeah, people here seem a bit miserable. Morning. Hello.
Ahoy.
How are you doing?
I said, you're lovely. Ahoy, ahoy.
Apart from that guy, who's obviously very nice. I don't have that far to go. And it is gorgeous outside. I can barely keep my eyes open. Look at that. Look at that view that I've been waking up to. I only got 100k to do today. That's like nothing. I do that before breakfast sometimes. Not today, I've had breakfast. No matter where you go, turn up.
You like football?
Yeah.
What's your favorite club?
Arsenal.
Arsenal?
Yeah.
Yeah, good Gunners. Okay.
Cool.
Okay, bye. Thank you.
See you. So it's actually the last day, day number 25, and I've only got 40 kilometers to go. I'm very excited to get to Auschwitz. A little bit nervous, but at least the roads are nice and bumpy to give me some entertainment for the ride. So I visited Lvov, which was mostly Jewish before the war. When the Nazis came in, they forced all the Jews of the town, like in many towns in the Ukraine, they forced many of them to be marched out to a hill, and they were just shot. Cold blood, no compassion for women, children, elderly, anything. They were just taken to a hill, shot, pushed down a hill, and buried over. When I came back from that trip, 6 months ago, I hit the gym the next day and just hit it so hard I went on the running machine and let out emotion through that. Sort of all I could feel was anger, so much so that I actually wished, I've never done before, but I threw up because I was just so angry that could have happened. And the same anger is coming here, you know. It's just incredibly upsetting, and it just makes you sort of want to slap someone and say, why? What? This is stupid. Absolutely stupid. Why would anyone do this? Why would, you know, I just can't imagine. It's just upsetting and angry how people could be tortured and killed. So many people just killed, so many lives wasted. It's just absolutely mad. Nearly there. Train tracks always freak me out. They took so many lives to these places, and I'm sure this one did too. Finally made it. 25 days on the road, 22 days cycling, 2,200 and approximately 22 kilometers. I'm exhausted. Fortunately, I think I've got most of my anger out. And now it's time to be sad and go around the whole camp. Right.
Slowly breaking through a daylight, slowly.